wondering, being brought up in a family that had so many strong women figures, was it a burden? Did you feel like you had to live up to all these famous Blackwell women?
No, I didn't. They didn't rub it into me. Of course, I knew my grandmother, Antoinette Blackwell, and I used to go to meetings with her, and I heard her talk and preach, and Cousin Alice Blackwell was quite famous, you see. She was a journalist in Boston, and I often heard her give speeches in big crowds, and I was considered a little queer because at school where I went, I was not only a suffragist, believing in women's suffrage, but I also was a Unitarian, which was quite unusual for in that town in my time. But it was all right, I got along fine. But I was supposed to be a little different. I marched in the parade, the suffrage parade, when I was a teenager. Who spoke? Carrie Chapman Catt. Well, Vincent Millay and, what was her name, the beautiful girl that rode on a big white horse, Inez Milholland, and they rode on big white horses in front of the parade, and then the rest of us walked miles from way downtown and Fifth Avenue up to Carnegie Hall, and heard the suffragists speak, and I wore a white dress with a ribbon over here and looked older than I was. My grandmother rode in a carriage with another suffrage lady. And there's a great difference between a suffragist and a suffragette.
What is the difference?
A suffragette would throw stones and chain themselves to doors and do all sorts of violent things, but a suffragist believed in women's votes, votes for women, but not getting it violently.
Now, history hasn't really treated the suffragists very well. I mean, everything is sort of lumped into the whole image of suffragette.
A lot of my relatives, when they made speeches for suffrage, had tomatoes and eggs and things thrown at them.
Even being on the suffragist?
Yes, even being a suffragist. Yeah. Of course, my grandmother, nobody ever thought she could possibly be a minister because women weren't allowed to speak in public even then. My aunt Lucy Stone, when she raised her hand at a church meeting in New Milford, Connecticut, about something, they were having a church meeting, and the moderator said, "Don't count that one, that's a woman." That made her so mad. And from then on, she was a suffragist.
Was that the beginning of her career?
Well, she had always felt that women were put down because she knew how hard her mother worked, how much her mother did. What little credit she got for it. She was the first woman from Massachusetts to go to college. This is Lucy Stone. And she went to Oberlin because Oberlin was the only place that would take a woman. And she had to teach and work quite hard to earn the money to go because her family didn't approve of women going to college. But she felt she must and would. So she did. And then when my grandmother, Antoinette, wanted to go, her parents didn't believe in it either, in a woman going to college. So she taught and got enough money to go. Her brother, her older brother, helped her. And on her way to Oberlin from where she was living at that time, near Geneva, New York, a place called Henrietta, it was a long distance to go from there to Oberlin, Ohio. You had to take a canal boat and a coach, stagecoach, and change to it. Train and this and that and the other. But she met on the train an elderly friend of her father's who was some political, and they chatted and had a nice visit together. And he said, "Now, let me tell you, there's somebody you should steer clear of at Oberlin. There's a young girl who's very forward, very modernistic, and we don't approve of her at all. Her name's Lucy Stone." So my grandmother, Antoinette, got to the Oval and she said, "Can you tell me which one is Lucy Stone?" She was seated at the table with Lucy Stone, who talked. My grandmother had been brought up to think that women at the table shouldn't talk too much, you know. You maybe ask a few questions or polite remarks, but you didn't talk about politics. And Lucy had ideas on all sorts of things. Well, anyway, they became eventually firm from bosom friends, and they both married a Blackwell. Lucy Stone married Henry, and my grandmother married Samuel Blackwell. So they both married brothers and became sisters-in-law. Lucy Stone edited the Woman's Journal for years and years and years until when women got the vote, it was given up. League of Women Voters took over by that time. And my grandmother, Aunt Annette, got a church and was ordained in Ohio, a small town in Ohio, who was willing to take a woman minister. And she stayed there for a while. But this was an Orthodox Congregational church. There were a lot of things she found that she was too liberal about, that just didn't believe, and she couldn't go on preaching to the people all these things. So she resigned and went to New York, and Horace Greeley, the Tribune editor, hired a big hall for her in New York, and she preached in New York for quite a while. And she had quite a big congregation because people were very curious to hear how a woman would be able to speak. I never heard a woman talk in public, and, really? And they thought it was a strange thing. So she always had quite a big congregation. She later had a church in Elizabeth, New Jersey, but she preached in churches all over New England.
Now, how did people on the Vineyard, were they impressed by the
liked her very much. All the people that knew her, she was just kind of a visiting relative. A lot of them called her Aunt Nettie, and they're all very fond of her.
Did the Vineyarders have any feeling about them being outspoken women?
No, because Aunt Nett's oldest daughter, Florence, married Elliot Mayhew, as I guess I told you. Elliot had the Chilmark store. And she and Elliot were instrumental in founding the library. First, they had a little library in the store, and then they went to the town hall, and then they finally got Katie West's house on the corner in Chilmark. Katie West had been deaf. She was really a welfare and on the town, so that the town had her house when she died. And Aunt Florence had it fixed up for a library, and it's grown bigger since. And she was a lay minister in the Methodist Church, and she used to go to meetings in Attleboro and all sorts of important meetings. And then she'd come back, and she preached sermons sometimes in the Methodist Church. So she was very active in the church and the library, and people liked that. She had a lot of very good friends, and she lived there. She was part of the town.